This is the news. We deal in facts. And what I'm about to tell you is a fact. I'm joined by one of our favorite guests. The acclaimed astrophysicist Neil deGrasse Tyson has spent decades exploring the mysteries of our universe and also explaining them in ways that we can understand. Now he's turned his attention to some of the problems in one planet on the universe, inside the universe, Earth. The new book, Starry Messenger, urges us to really think critically and objectively about what we're up to and whether we can keep this planet we have here. He writes, we sow hatred of others fueled by what we think is true or what we want to be true without regard to what is true. We've lost all sight of what distinguishes facts from opinions. We lob grenades at one another when we could be sharing beers in pubs. Neil is here. Shout out to drinking together and finding facts. Great to see you.
Thanks. Actually, I lean towards wine, but beer is...
You wrote beer.
I did write beer. I totally wrote beer there.
We know you from so many things, but you're clearly taking the scientific rigor that people love about you and I think sometimes learn from you and applying it to some really big topics. Why this now? What do you want us to think about?
This book has been gestating within me for decades. Just, in fact, I can remember my first thoughts when I was scientifically literate, early middle school. I'd look around and I'd see adults saying things, making decisions, commenting, holding opinions. I was like, what? Where did that come from? Have you thought about it this way? Do you understand the data, the statistics? And it's been gestating within me. And then the book was birthed whole.
Wow.
And I realized all of these parts of society could benefit from a dose of a cosmic perspective, just what does that look like from above, but also an infusion of science literacy and critical thinking in a way where your argument that you thought you held firmly and you thought you were opposite the person you were fighting with, in fact, from another perch, you could learn that you both actually agree more than you disagree. Or you're both equally wrong, and you realize it together. Okay, either of those are progress in any kind of between any warring factions in modern society.
Yeah, you mentioned the factions. Some of this goes back a long way. People debating what is God, who's got the right belief system. I mean, that's old school stuff, right?
Yeah, that is. However, this country, the United States, was quite the fascinating experiment in that regard. It's whatever is your personal truth, it's welcomed, but you can't tell someone else, you can't require someone else have your personal truth. And that gave religion freedom to express itself in all stripes, in all varieties in this country. That's remarkable. And so, but that's a particular kind of truth. In the chapter Truth and Beauty, I go into this in great detail, but I had to split the word truth into three parts because there are many people who, especially religions, they really attach themselves to the word truth, and I don't want to take that away from them. So there's a personal truth. Is Jesus your savior? Is Abraham your, you know, in your lineage? Is Muhammad your last savior? Are your ancestors watching you? These are cherished beliefs, and it works provided that if you have that belief, you don't then rise to power over laws and legislation and have those laws and legislation force others into that same belief system. So the pluralistic feature of this country, I think, is something that can and should be cherished. So how does science distinguish? Oh, wait, slip in a political truth. You know what that is?
What's that?
It's what becomes true simply because it got repeated so many times. Our brain has this failure mode. Well, we think it's a success mode where you hear something so many times, your brain says, must be true.
Well, yeah, repetition is a big part of campaigns.
It's the foundation of all. What did Hitler do with the, what's the term there, where you believe this and I'm going to print this and it's not
propaganda.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you. Like, thank you for helping
me. You guys, the question, but you asked me the question, what did Hitler do? And I was like, well,
a lot.
Well, which thing?
A lot. So repetition is a foundation of propaganda. But the scientific truth is what you establish to be true through experiment, observations, repeated, right. verified. And when that is done, it is true whether or not you believe in it. And if you're going to base laws and
right.
on something that has to apply to everybody, it seems to me the objective truth should be your primary motive.
So you say objective truth just yes. then. Let me read from you on objective truth in the book. Objective truths of science are not found in belief systems. They're not established by the authority of leaders or the power of persuasion, nor are they learned from repetition or gleaned from magical thinking. To deny objective truths is to be scientifically illiterate, not to be ideologically principled. Explain that important
That's one of my
split.
Best sentences in the book. Thanks
yeah?
for finding that.
Well, we found it. But explain that split, because you do something that I think is very important. That sometimes belief and ideology, especially the way we're tribally organized, which you also write about, becomes its own test. If you're down with this goal, you got to be down with this other stuff. And then before you know it, that means being down with things that at one point you might have known were questionable or not true. And now you glom onto them.
It's a portfolio, portfolio of beliefs.
Walk us through that.
Well, no, because science, one of the things it does best is unpack things that are otherwise glued together that you think all have to roll in one coherent shape. You unpack it and say, no, this works, but that doesn't. No, I'm not going to ride with that because you've attached it to this, but I'm not going to go with you on that because I'm thinking about this. What happens is we like following leaders, and we let them do our thinking for us. And I can't embrace that.
No, that wouldn't seem like your thing.
I can't. I don't mind leaders, but that doesn't mean I have to agree with everything the leader says, okay? And so what it means is if you pose an argument, there might be holes in that argument. And you need to be a little bit open to that. And I don't mean holes that I'm right and you're wrong. It could be a hole that, well, we're both wrong, and here's a new place we can agree on, and that's when you go out and have a beer. There's an unwritten ethos between two scientists in an argument. And that unwritten ethos is either I'm right and you're wrong, or you're right and I'm wrong, or we're both wrong. Mm. We know that in advance. So we're not fighting to the death. You fight to the point where you say, you know, this extra bit of data will help decide which of these worldviews is correct.
And can I join you in that? I'm guessing that with scientists, if they acknowledge that error rates exist and vary, but virtually no humans or systems have 100% accuracy, sooner or later, they will be on the wrong side of an empirical debate.
Well, so, I mean, you have to understand how science works, and that's not taught in school. Hmm. You know how it's taught in school? Here's a book, and the vocabulary words are in boldface in the chapter.
Right.
Memorize those, and you test it, and then you move on. Where do you learn what science is and how and why it works and why you can trust it and what it means to trust it? What do you have to do to get to the point where you can believe what the scientist says and not the person who wishfully thinks something is different?
So I have a big question for you because you tackle ethics and there are different competing systems of ethics. Historically on Earth, many of them have involved some appeal to a higher power.
Yes.
This power or this God creates this ethics. Are there ethics in the non-human rest of the galaxy?
I don't know. Ethics as well as just sort of morality. I can tell you this. Whatever ethics or morality we agree to have as society progresses, and by the way, the ethos of today was not the same as 50 years ago or 100 years ago. You know, there would have been another day when I would have been a slave, okay? And so the ethics and morality evolves. And it evolves according to sort of rational discourse about what is right and what is wrong.
Are there permanent ethics on Earth, do you think? Can you point to any that are permanent?
I don't know what's permanent, but I do know that if you think something is permanent, that's usually not a good sign because you attach to it. And then as the world moves on, you could have a different outlook on that. I'm old enough to remember the Sunday newspaper had a section called the women's section. That was like sort of ethically the right thing, because what do women do? They are at home, and in that section were recipes and coupons and all the things women did at home. And nobody nobody critiqued that for decades.
Right.
And finally, we get into the 1970s and the moving frontier of the second wave women's lib movement, and all that changed. But it took that long to do it. You needed an entire civil rights movement to happen first, and then everyone said, well, how about the women? And that, so I will not accept something as eternally true, given that we continue to mature in this world. And this treatise is an attempt to show you how your most cherished feelings, maybe there's holes in them. Mm. But you kind of have to be open to that a little. And I try to be playful in ways, you know, just so that you're not thinking this. I'm not lecturing at you here. And the book is not even very long. It's 200 pages. It's not even very big. So it's there for you to taste.
So before I lose you, because I wanted to jump around to the book, I was
Please, I'm doing too much talking here. Go.
No, you're here to talk. You then turn to physiology. Why is that important to you that we explore our understanding of that?
Oh, my gosh. Because in the body and mind chapter, think about it. We judge what is normal and what is not. Mm. And what does that even mean? Is normal just the average? Is a normal person, do we compare, you have model homes. Is there a model person that has all their working faculties, and then you compare yourself to that, and if you're not that, you're not normal? Are you disabled if they can do something and you can't?
Right.
Is that how you want to do this? Because if that's the case, I give examples, okay? The New York Yankees, okay? Jim Abbott was a pitcher for the New York Yankees. He threw a no-hitter for the New York Yankees. Oh, by the way, he only has one hand, okay? He has... How do you do this, right?
I mean, that's pretty great.
Okay. And there's another person who's a champion archer, okay? A champion archer can shoot arrows both better than nearly everyone on Earth. He was born without arms. Am I going to say that he's disabled because I have arms and he doesn't? No, I'm not going to do that. You can't make me do that because we're all who we are, and you work with the hand. Are you disabled because you can't do math? Okay, is that how we're going to think about it?
How did you know I was bad at math? You had a feeling. I am. You just knew it. You looked at you. You look like you're bad at math.
If I can't draw, am I disabled because I'm not an artist? So there's a whole analysis of how we define what is normal and what is not. And the reason why an astrophysicist is telling you about this is because we have the entire universe that we classify. Is there a star? Is it odd? Is it average? Is it this? How do we lay them out? How do we think about them?
That goes to the final question.
Yes.
We are living in a time of unparalleled technological advancement, and yet we're saddled by all of this misinformation and stupidity. We're seeing more of the galaxy, I believe, tell me if I'm wrong, than we've ever seen in previous generations. You write, ranked by distance, sight is very important. The farthest thing visible to the human eye is a twin of our own Milky Way, the Andromeda. The Andromeda Galaxy.
Named for the woman saved by Perseus in Greek legend.
Yeah.
Andromeda.
Well, there's a J. Cole song, She Don't Want to Be Saved, but that's for another
time. Okay. she was about to be consumed by the Kraken, so she wanted to be saved.
And you write, it sits 2 million light years away, far beyond the stars of the night sky. What does it do for us, in English, plain English, that we have gone as a global community from seeing that far with, as you say, the naked eye, to what we're now seeing just in the last years, farther through the galaxy and its own history? What can we as a people, what is someone watching the program, what do they take from that day-to-day life that we can now see more of the galaxy than ever?
You can take one of the greatest of all cosmic perspectives that exist, and it's the revelation that emerged mid-20th century that the atoms of our body are traceable to the crucibles in the centers of stars that then later exploded, scattering that enrichment into pristine gas clouds that then form star systems with planets, one of which was the Sun with Earth, so that we're not simply in this universe alive, yes. The universe is alive within us. That is a gift of modern astrophysics to civilization that borders on the spiritual. Mm. So that when you stand out in the night sky and look up, do you say, well, I'm small and the universe is big? You might say that and it'd be true, but a bigger fact than that is you are made of the same ingredients as those stars. We are not just poetically, we are literally stardust that achieve consciousness to contemplate the extent of the universe in which we live. And so the greater is that moving horizon, the more of this we find that we are participant of in the great unfolding of cosmic events.
Spending a little time with your mind is a joy. A joy. I think I got part of what you said. Neil deGrasse Tyson, the book Starry Messenger is in bookstores now. Hey, I'm Ari Melber. Thanks for watching The Beat. I wanted to let you know I'm writing a foreword to the January 6th committee's full report, which is coming out soon from HarperCollins. You can go pre-order the book right now, and it'll come to you first when the report comes out in the fall or whenever the government releases it. Just search Melber Jan 6th on Amazon or your favorite independent book site and click pre-order. You'll be the first to get both the report and my new piece on the coup conspiracy. You can also go to melberbook.com and order it there.